This is Sports Talk, home to great debates and the hottest sports topics. Now, here are your hosts, Jeremy Farina, Justin Paolillo, and Holden Perelli.
Hello, North Haven, and welcome to this edition of Sports Talk. I'm Jeremy Farina here with Justin Paolillo and Holden Perelli. Today, we're going to start our show off with a little bit of trade discussions. Obviously, the NBA had their trade deadline. A lot of deals went down, and I'm just going to have each of our panelists pick one of these deals that they really liked. Justin, we'll start with you.
I have to say, at the time, my favorite deal was the Goran Dragic deal that sent him over to the Heat along with his brother, Zoran Dragic. Unfortunately, Chris Bosh went down with the season-ending blood clots in his lungs, which it was sad to hear because I remember I tweeted right after he got traded. I said the Heat are legit now because for years now, I mean, they've been winning titles because LeBron's there as the point forward, but they've never had a point guard, an elite point guard on their team, and they're getting that in Dragic, in my opinion. I mean, he's only 27 years old, so he's got a solid 4 or 5 years left as far as highly productive basketball, but he'll be good after that as well. So I think this was a very good move for the Heat, especially if Bosh stayed healthy. I mean, if you got a starting lineup of Dragic, Wade, Deng, Bosh, and Hassan Whiteside, who's a great up-and-coming player in this league, that's a pretty good lineup. And I think that's, especially in that Eastern Conference, that people say it's bad. Obviously, it's worse than the West. I mean, it's up-and-coming, but it's worse than the West. So if you're going to win, if you want to be in any conference as a good team, you're going to want to be in the East. But so that's where they were. So I thought they had a good opportunity to make a decent run. But I thought that was a good trade. And I still think it is a good trade because they're going to re-sign him. Dragic said he wants to stay there. And if you can re-sign him, Whiteside's only going to get better. Wade can only get healthier. Bosh will be coming back from the blood clots. And Deng will still be there. They can add some pieces to their bench. So that was definitely a good trade for the Heat moving forward.
Yeah, I thought the Oklahoma City trade for Enes Kanter was a pretty decent pickup for OKC. And they gave up Kendrick Perkins, who went to the Jazz, ultimately got bought out, and now he's in Cleveland. So really, it's been a good move for all three teams, because from the Utah Jazz's perspective, they got rid of Enes Kanter, who was about to be a free agent this summer, and he probably command a good amount of money. He was splitting minutes with Rudy Gobert, who's an up-and-coming Frenchman big man, who's pretty talented on the defensive side of the basketball floor. So now he'll get more minutes to develop and grow. They got draft picks in that deal. Oklahoma City gets Enes Kanter, who was averaging 13-8 while splitting minutes. Now he can be the go-to big man in Oklahoma City unless Steven Adams comes back fully healthy. They have a lot more front court depth now on that roster because Kendrick Perkins, at 30 years old, wasn't giving Oklahoma City that defensive anchor that they so desperately needed, because Steven Adams was taking a majority of the minutes. Now they have Enes Kanter, who can give you a little bit more of a low post presence on the offensive side of the floor. So I really like that pickup for OKC, especially when you're playing with Kevin Durant and Russell Westbrook. Enes Kanter is going to get some great opportunities to score the basketball. And in terms of Cleveland's perspective, they added more front court depth to their team because Anderson Varejao went down with a season-ending injury. So they picked up Kendrick Perkins, who can be a defensive anchor for Cleveland. They already have Timothy Mozgov, but we know Cleveland can score with LeBron, Kyrie, and Love. What they desperately needed was more defensive role players, and they got that with Kendrick.
I think if you're looking at almost a feel-good deal is the Kevin Durant and the Thaddeus Young trade. Brooklyn obviously sends Kevin Garnett to Minnesota, where he started his career. Kind of good that he's going to end his career there, and it's a good move financially for Minnesota because he has an expiring contract, so they get him off the table. Garnett ends his career where he started, and then obviously they save the money they would have had tied up in Thaddeus Young, who ends up moving on to Brooklyn. But a deal that I probably liked the most was the huge one, really, the four-team deal between the Celtics, 76ers, and Suns, and then the Bucks. But before I say my opinions on that, I'm going to let you guys take your shots first. So, Holden, what do you think of this deal?
I thought it was a strange deal for the Bucks. Yes, they picked up Michael Carter-Williams, who is the reigning rookie of the year, but you have to put it in perspective, his stats and numbers in perspective. He was playing on a team in Philadelphia with the coach Brett Brown, who liked to play a helter-skelter form of basketball, similar to Mike D'Antoni when he was in Phoenix. Up and down the court, frenetic pace, you're jacking up as many shots as you can, so obviously your numbers are inflated. Look at Evan Turner in Boston versus what he was in Philadelphia. His numbers are completely different between both teams. And Michael Carter-Williams has an injury right now, a toe injury. He's been out for a great deal of time. I think going to Milwaukee, playing for a guy like Jason Kidd, who is a former point guard great, probably a future Hall of Famer, he'll get to learn and develop. But Brandon Knight was putting up some good numbers for Milwaukee. I'm sure, Justin, you followed him. 18 points, 6 assists a game, and he's a really great combo guard. I think Milwaukee only gave him up because he was in the final year of his contract. He would probably command top dollar if Eric Bledsoe got a max contract with Phoenix. But now Phoenix gets a dual threat combo guard in Brandon Knight. But we already saw what Phoenix tried to do with three-point guards. Now they're going to have to figure out how to do it. And it was already a mess with Goran Dragic and Eric Bledsoe. They never seemed to figure it out together because Eric Bledsoe was out with injury. Now you're throwing Brandon Knight into the mix. I don't know how that chemistry is going to balance out. So I thought that was kind of a strange move.
Personally, I love this move on all four teams part of it because, like, I was like, Holden, I was a little shocked because Brandon Knight wasn't really a part of too many trade rumors. Like, before the deadline this past Thursday, you heard Dragic and all the trade rumors. You heard the possible Kevin Garnett moving to Minnesota, and you heard other guys who wanted to be traded, Enes Kanter and Reggie Jackson, who went to the Pistons. But I like this move because the Suns, they had those three-point guards, and everybody thought it was going to work out. And I personally wasn't a big fan of it at first because Dragic's numbers went way down, and he was a borderline all-star. He was a third-team All-NBA last year, and that's very tough to do as a point guard. So, I mean, you got to give him props last year, and then he comes in this year, and he's not even starting. So I thought it was great to get Dragic to the Heat. And then also you trade Isaiah Thomas to the Celtics, who can go there and do what he does best, just score. He's not expected to lead this team into the playoffs, the championship. He's just going to go there and score. He's going to mentor young Marcus Smart a little bit. So I think that worked out great for the Celtics. I really like what the Bucks did here. I am obviously a Bucks fan, and I liked Brandon Knight a lot, but I didn't like how he had a shoot-first mentality. And I think especially when Jabari comes back next year, they have a lot of great wing offensive players with Chris Middleton, Ersan Ilyasova, who could step back and knock down some threes. So I think that having a guy like Carter Williams who, you know, can get you 10, 12 assists any night he wants, I think that's great. And he's always looking to pass because he's not the greatest outside shooter. So I think that just balances out the Bucks. As far as the Suns go, you're getting a guy like Knight, who I think is better playing at the two-guard spot, who could also slide into the one to give Bledsoe a break. But I would like to see Bledsoe and Knight start at the one and two. And then as far as the 76ers goes, look, their plan is just to get draft picks. That's what they did. We'll see how it works out. I really like this trade, too, for the 76ers because you get rid of Michael Carter-Williams. And there has been reports, and I agree with this, too, that they're going for Emmanuel Mudiay, who I think is definitely going top three in this draft. He skipped college just like Brandon Jennings did and went over to China to play, and he's projected to be a top three pick. So I think they got rid of Carter-Williams. They're expecting a high pick this year. If they can grab Mudiay, you got Embiid coming back, Noel's still there, some other draft picks. So I think this worked out for all four teams. I liked it.
I like it for the Celtics because now you get, obviously, Isaiah Thomas to come in, Marcus Smart already seems to be the guy they wanted to build around, and just adding another explosive guard that's able to score, too, it could work. The only thing I worry is if maybe both of them want to handle the ball or something like that, but I don't think that's going to be an issue. But the only thing is I think they'd still be one more piece away if Marcus Smart did develop into the guy that they want him to, but obviously Celtics, they're kind of an historic franchise. It'd be a little easier for them compared to a team maybe like Milwaukee to draw one of these guys in. But Philadelphia, I don't know if I like this move for them. It seems like what they were trying to do was build around Michael Carter-Williams and Embiid and who they had coming back. And I thought that Michael Carter-Williams was one of the better pieces they had. Obviously, one rookie of the year, he's got to be doing something right. And to trade him, I didn't see what it was for. And then I see maybe they're trying to, you know, get salary off or whatever it is. And then they pick up Thomas Robinson off of waivers, and that actually puts them under the cap. Or above the cap, so I don't really understand what they were doing there with that move. If they let Robinson go and not claim him, I guess it makes more sense. But to go from being $3 million under to over the cap, I just didn't agree with that move. And then the Suns, obviously you had to get rid of the three guys you had there. It wasn't working out with Bledsoe, Thomas, and Dragic. Moving them, bringing in Knight, I think that could work better than it was working before because you only have two guys, and Knight is obviously a good scorer. Bledsoe's a good scorer as well, so maybe that'll help balance it out as well. and the Bucks. I like them getting Mike Carter Williams. I think that he's going to have to play different than he did in Philadelphia, but he's also going to have a lot more talent around him than he did in Philly. So I think that the move is going to work out better for him, and I think he's going to be overall better off in Milwaukee. And that's going to be a scary group of guys in a couple of years when they all develop.
Jabari comes back, yeah.
And I wasn't really surprised that Michael Carter Williams got traded in the first place, because going back to this past draft, when Elfrid Payton got drafted, he was originally drafted by the 76ers, and Michael Carter Williams was at that draft, and he looked pretty shocked when Elfrid Payton got drafted by the Sixers. Obviously, he ended up going to the Magic, but for that moment, I mean, you could sort of infer already that the 76ers weren't completely invested.
They didn't have him in his future plans.
Michael Carter Williams as their future point guard.
And another kind of under the radar move by the Bucks in that trade was they got Miles Plumlee and Tyler Ennis, two young guys from the Suns who. And saddens me to say this, but Larry Sanders was bought out and will possibly retire from the NBA. So they're already a man down low. They're losing their starting center. So bring a guy like Plumlee, who was a starter last year, to come off your bench and really help out that front line. And Tyler Ennis, who could help, he's another backcourt scorer, and I think he could develop nice. So I think it was an overall good move for the Bucks. If I had to pick one winner, I would think they came out on this on top, considering they traded their best player.
And Justin, what about the Aaron Aflalo move, though?
I like the Aaron Aflalo move because the Trailblazers have been criticized over the past couple years of having a very bad bench. And this year was a little better than previous years, but it's still no different. Their bench isn't great. Steve Blake and Chris Kaman do help, but you know they're not going to give you 30 points a night off the bench. So bringing a guy like Aflalo, who pretty much it's going to be like Isaiah Thomas of the Celtics. He's going to come in. They're going to say, just score the basketball. That's all we need you to do. We don't need you to set screens. We don't need you to pass, rebound. Just go behind the three-point line, go in isolation, and just score the basketball. And especially with Nick Batum going down with injury and Wesley Matthews, he's a good, nice backup to have coming off your bench. If one of them goes down again, he can step right in and start at the 2 or 3.
Another move that you mentioned earlier with the Pistons picking up Reggie Jackson from OKC, I think that was a good move too, because you had Brennan Jennings. He obviously got hurt. A lot of people were worrying that they were going to have someone to step in. You can move him in, and even when Jennings is back and healthy, you still have those guys both playing. So that could be a good move as well.
And a part of that move with the Pistons were they helped their bench a lot. They got Kyle Singler to be coming off their bench. DJ Augustine, who, in my opinion, is the best backup point guard in the league right now, he's coming to back up Russell Westbrook. He could also, Westbrook could also play off the ball when DJ's on the floor, so I think that was a great move. They got Cantor, so the OKC Thunder, clearly they want to win now. I think this is almost as a sort of they're reaching out to Durant, Westbrook, please stay, because we're building this team around you. They have Waiters there, so they're definitely building for the future, and that was a good move.
Reggie Jackson was, I agree with you, Jeremy, a pretty smart pickup. You lose your starting point guard in Detroit, and Reggie Jackson, when he was out there alone with just Ibaka when Durant and Westbrook were hurt at the beginning of the season, he played pretty well. He was averaging 20 points and 8 assists. Now, at the moment, that was a bad team, but still 20 points and 8 assists, those are decent numbers. And going to a situation with Greg Monroe and Andre Drummond, there's some talent there. And a great coaching staff, I think it could turn out well, and they're back in the playoff hunt.
The only difficulty is, what do you do when Jennings comes back next year? Do you trade one of them? Do you? Because Jackson is going to be a free agent this offseason, so do you re-sign him? Do you let him go if Jennings is there? It's tough.
I don't know. I'm pretty sure Jennings was only on a 3-year deal, I believe, in Detroit, and they could possibly move him if they think he comes. They don't think he's doing well after he comes back from a torn Achilles, and we saw how that.
Especially if Jackson
plays
well.
For a guy
well.
Like Kobe. Now, Kobe's Kobe. He rehabs from almost everything. But is that going to work for Brandon Jennings?
Especially if Jackson starts, like he did with the...
Up,
what if he
yeah.
starts dropping, 20 and 10? It's going to be tough to let him go.
Absolutely. But moving on, we're going to talk about someone who was traded a little bit earlier before the trade deadline. Rajon Rondo was moved to Dallas. We all, I think, agreed that it was a good move. But it seems like a lot of controversy, I guess you could say, is going on. Rick Carlisle and him got in a fight, and he got suspended for a game. Do you guys think Rondo is ultimately a good fit for Dallas? Justin, we'll start with you.
I definitely do think Rondo's a good fit for Dallas. I mean, as far as not getting along with the coach goes, there was a report last night that said it was just a misunderstanding or a difference of opinion over what play to call. So I don't think this event this event or any events like this will continue throughout the season. And if they're on the same page, him and Carlisle, I think Rondo fits in great with them because Dirk's going to be your scorer. Chandler Parsons is there. All of them really, aside from Dirk, really can't create their own shot. And Rondo's, when healthy, I think is the best passer in the game. So that only helps your team in throwing lobs to Chandler. And I just think he fits in perfectly with that team. Great, he's a great defensive point guard, and that's what you need in the West against Russell Westbrook, who's been tearing it up lately. Chris Paul has been playing very good since Blake Griffin went down with the elbow injury, and you got Damian Lillard out there. So every team you're going to play in the playoffs is going to have a good point guard. So if you have a guy like Rondo to play defense, and we saw what he did when he was in Boston, playing great defense, just leading that team on both ends of the floor. I think if he could play like that in Dallas, I think Dallas has a great chance of going to the Western Conference Finals and maybe even the NBA Finals. So I think he's a good fit.
Yeah, I definitely think that, you know, I'm confident in saying I think the Rajon Rondo situation in Dallas will work itself out. If you think about Jason Kidd, I remember reading stories about him early on in his career in Dallas with Rick Carlisle. They got into a couple of altercations and verbal fights, but obviously what happened?
They won a title.
They won a title, and it worked out, and everyone was happy. I think the same thing could be said of what is going on in Dallas right now with Rajon Rondo. This guy is a walking triple-double when healthy. He shows up in the biggest moments in the playoffs. I think he set a record for most triple-doubles in the postseason. This guy just needs to be in a good set of mind and good health. When he was playing in Boston, no matter the situation, he was comfortable. He was playing carefree and just having fun out there, and we saw what he was doing. He was averaging a double-double every night. So I think you need to replicate that situation in Dallas, and it's possible because you have so many weapons on that court. All you need to ask Rondo to do is organize the show. He doesn't need to score. He doesn't need to do rebound on the boards. Just get everyone where they need to be and be a floor general out there on the court. And I think with a great coach like Rick Carlisle, you got a great owner upstairs in Mark Cuban, Chandler Parsons, Dirk, Tyson Chandler, the list goes on and on. I think after, maybe if he re-signs there for the long term, next season could be even better for Rajon Rondo. Right now, he's only averaging 23 minutes a game, but I think he's just getting adjusted to life in Dallas.
Yeah, I like the move initially. I thought they had one of the better starting fives. I just worry that Rajon isn't able to avoid the drama. It seems like when it was Kevin Garnett and Paul Pierce there always seemed to be some sort of altercation between him and Garnett or Pierce, whatever it is. I think if this guy just goes, gets comfortable in the system, like Holden said, with the coaching staff and with the players and just Dallas in general, I think that this could definitely work out because they have so many good scorers. And obviously, if he's able to distribute the ball the way that Dallas is hoping he's able to, a lot of these guys are going to get open shots. And like I said, Dirk is probably the only one. I mean, maybe Monte that can really Monte. Create their own shot. And then the other guys kind of are not relying on the point guard, but it's easier for them to score if they got someone setting them up. But overall, I think that it's definitely a good fit. It's just a matter of them really putting their differences aside and focusing on the one goal, which is ultimately to play in the NBA Finals.
I think a tough part about what's going on with, say, Rondo on the Dallas, or should I say the only downside, I think, is in the late game in the fourth quarter, Monte Ellis is doing most of the ball handling because he's going to be the go-to guy in the fourth, him or Dirk, but he's going to be carrying the ball up. So, and Rondo hasn't been, he's never been a good shooter in his career, and you know, he's not going to be, you know, getting lobs from anybody. So he really needs the ball in his hands, and he needs to be the passer. It's really tough when he's playing off the ball. It's almost like a waste of a player because he's not going to shoot a three in the corner. So what is he really doing besides trying to go for an offensive rebound? So that's why I think maybe Rajon's a little upset. But I, like you said, Jeremy, or both you guys said, I think as the season progresses, it'll only get better for them. And we'll see how it goes.
I never really thought of what the dynamic would be like between Monte Ellis and Rajon Rondo, because Rondo has never really played off the ball at any point in his career. When he was in Boston, he had Ray Allen. Ray Allen's just a spot-up shooter. When he was with Avery Bradley was just an on-ball defender. He really never did much on the offensive side of the floor. But now he's playing with Monte. Monte, like, in Monte's career, he's never really played off the ball either. He's always been, you know, the instigator, the guy that gets the offense going. He really excels at creating his own shot, and therefore he needs the ball in his hand at all times. And he's never really played off the ball, so now you're putting two guys together who've never really played off the ball. It created,
and one of them's got to.
One of them's got to. Rondo's obviously got the short end of the stick right now because obviously Coach Carlisle has more faith in Ellis right now, obviously with the familiarity of playing with each other for more than a year.
Yeah, I think that was obviously the biggest maybe what-if factor in the trade was how is it going to work with Ellis and Rondo both normally having the ball in their hands.
Let me ask you this, Jeremy. Do you think Dallas will want to keep him, or do you think Rondo will want to stay? Maybe let's say they don't get into another fight, but let's say maybe they get knocked out of the second round. Maybe Rondo's minutes stay relatively low, or maybe he gets into another fight with Carlisle. But do you think if things stay the way they do as of right now, do you think he'll re-sign there, or do you think he'll look elsewhere?
I mean, I think Rondo will look elsewhere. I mean, regardless of the situation, if the Dallas is saying, you know, we'll keep you for, you know, $15 million a year, and then someone else is offering $18 million a year, obviously he's going to be enticed to look elsewhere. But Dallas, I think, will definitely go for him because there's not really a lot of elite point guards in the league that, I mean, not every team's got a great point guard. You always need that guy that's going to orchestrate your offense. So I think that's going to be hard for them to just kind of let him go. But I think that Rondo will definitely look elsewhere. I mean, there's been rumors the Lakers are going to pursue him and other teams like that. I mean, I don't know why he would want to go to the Lakers. But
the Lakers could technically get anybody.
I tell you what, you know what would be a deadly pairing? If Rondo were to leave Dallas and go to San Antonio.
Kevin Love goes to L.A.?
No. If he goes, if Kevin Love left and went to L.A. and then Rondo met him up there and Kobe comes back healthy. But let's say Kevin Love doesn't move. He resigns in Cleveland. Obviously, Kobe's staying in L.A. What if Rondo were to go to San Antonio and fall into Greg Popovich's lap? Because you're going to a situation where you're playing with Tony Parker and Manu Ginobili. Manu might retire, but if he doesn't, Manu's used to playing off the ball or with the ball, and Tony Parker's used to playing on the ball, with the ball, or off the ball, because those guys have been together for so many years and have had great success. So now you put Rondo in that situation running that system.
So would he be coming off the bench there?
I think, honestly, he would be starting. You put Tony Parker at the two, or bring Tony off the bench even, possibly. That would be deadly.
You gotta wonder if he'd be intrigued to go there, though, because these guys are approaching the end of their career, if anything. He's not gonna want to sign a long-term deal there because...
And then be stuck in a rebuilding situation.
5 years, and after 2 years, Tim Duncan retires.
Right.
Pull Park, all these guys
I mean, unless
go.
They re-sign Kawhi, you True. Got Craig Popovich there, they've always struck gold in the draft. Now you add Rondo to that equation, it could be interesting to see, but I think he'll stay in Dallas because Mark Cuban's a great owner who's never been afraid to throw money at any player. You got Dirk, I think, will be there for the next 2 years. You already have a young weapon in Chandler Parsons who's only getting better and better. Chandler's probably got 2 or 3 years left in the tank. Monte Ellis is there, and if they wanted to resign Rondo and it doesn't work out, I think if you're picking between Rondo and Ellis, you probably move Ellis because he's the older player and Rondo's an elite point guard in the game and you can't find those every day.
I think another destination is Houston too because you look Harden. You got Harden there. I mean, you can move Beverly out and put him on the bench. Makes your bench even better. And then you have Dwight and Josh Smith there. I mean, I'm not going to say Josh Smith isn't
he's
a player by any means.
But he's a good player.
Right, right. But I think that situation could be good because... I mean, Harden's kind of been really doing everything with the ball. You put him off ball, and he could become even deadlier. So I think that's probably one of the best places he can go.
What I think would be a great place for him would be Indiana Pacers. I mean, they really have never had that. They've never had a great point guard. And George Hill is a good shooter, but if they can, you know, make it work out as far as money goes, I think if Paul George is coming back, he'll be 100% healthy next year. Maybe Rodney Stuckey's at the two or CJ right. Miles. If David West is there and Roy Hibbert, I think Rondo would be a great fit there. He'd do virtually all the ball handling for the team. He'd be able to hit guys like Paul George in the lob, feed Hibbert down low. He'd be able to drive into the lane.
I think it's a great fit, but Rondo has always been a tricky guy to think of off the court. You never really hear much about what he does off the court. He's a quiet guy, keeps to himself, but you know he's Kobe-like in his demeanor. He's kind of a lone wolf. He likes to, you know, he'll get after you, and he's feisty, and he'll demand the best out of you. Is he really going to fit? I mean, would he want to stay in a, would he want to sign with Indiana in Indiana? It's a small market. This guy started out in Boston. Boston's a big city. It's a big market. Go down to Dallas, Texas. That's a big market. I think Rondo's looking for top dollar, and I don't think Indiana would be able to offer him a contract like Chris Paul got. I think that's what Rondo wants. He wants $100 million. He wants the top dollar, and he's going to need to go to a big market
like the
or
Knicks.
Re-sign in Dallas.
Well, he's going to the Knicks.
I mean, yeah, the Knicks could be.
Well, Melo said he wanted him to play.
They only have Carmelo Anthony on their roster with a big, who has a big paycheck. I mean,
Grab Rondo,
I think they have three guys under contract. It's Calderon, Anthony, and then Hardaway.
And they're
Rondo with his ego would probably like the situation in New York, because the conflict right now he's having in Dallas is Rick Carlisle likes calling the plays, but Rondo's entire career has been so used to being the floor general and him calling the plays and marching and sending the marching orders around the court and demanding each player to do what he's asked them to do. Now Rick Carlisle's doing that. He's kind of had to give him that. He's had to give up that responsibility, and he's not used to it, which is leading to conflict. But if he goes to New York, Derek Fish is a young coach, okay? He doesn't really know what he's doing. Yes, he's, you know, he was a veteran point guard in the league.
He's got it under tabs. He's
still learning on the job. But Rondo can go there and say, hey, I can be like Peyton Manning in Denver. I can kind of go and run the show and everything. Carmelo Anthony's all he wants to do is score, so I can just get him the ball. I mean, if you think of it from that perspective, it could be very enticing for Rondo. The money, the responsibilities, you're playing with Carmelo Anthony, Eastern Conference.
If they could sign him early in free agency, that might be enough to lure one of the guys like maybe a Marcus Gasol into New York. And then you argue they have big three there with Rondo, Gasol, and
who knows?
Carmelo.
Like, you know, I'll see the Knicks get a big three.
Or the Knicks get the number one pick and pick Jahlil Okafor.
Worry,
then they have him.
Yeah, no, Jeremy thinks they're going to get the first
pick. There's
no
way they're not going to. It's so easy this year for the NBA
because,
to pick the lottery.
Because what happened?
It's going to be the Lakers and the Knicks with the two lowest records.
Decades ago, the Knicks had the worst record, but they got the number one pick, and who did they draft?
Patrick Ewing.
Center, big man. I mean, this is it all over again.
But if Jahlil played on Georgetown, I'd understand.
Justin, the Knicks get the first pick.
Yeah.
The Knicks get the first pick.
New York needs to have a basketball team.
When was the last time the team with the best odds to win the draft lottery?
They might have the best odds.
The Knicks are going
to have the best odds.
The Knicks are going to get the number one pick.
And suddenly, this is going to be the year when the team with the best odds won it.
They're going to get the number one pick. They're going to get Jahlil at the 5, Carmelo at the 3, sign Rondo at the 1.
We're getting Kevin Love, too.
Yeah. They might. Why don't you get LaMarcus Aldridge Kawhi Leonard?
I mean, that's a big three
they're
in itself.
Aldridge! Oh!
No, LaMarcus Aldridge is retiring as a player.
That's a big three. I mean, that's a big three.
Look,
work.
Jackson's the one luring them in.
Everybody's hoping for this. I guarantee you they're going to draft, say, Jahlil. Maybe he plays well. Melo will be hurt next year. Maybe they don't get Rondo.
And Melo's not going to be hurt when Kevin Love's taking half the shots that he's taking. He's going to be like, go, Kev.
Kevin Love would not fit well with Carmelo. Because
he fits all right with LeBron James.
Well, Love's not playing great. I don't know if
I don't think he's going to go to New York. I think he'll either stay in Cleveland or go to Los Angeles where he played college ball. But I agree with you, Jeremy. I bet you right now $10 with Justin that they're going to get the number one pick.
They're going to
get Jahlil or Carl Anthony Towns. They're going to get one of the two. They're going to have the number one pick. So they're going to pick one of those two guys, have Carmelo at the 3, Rondo, come play with these new toys, and they're going to be in the playoffs again. They're going to see the Knicks every single weekend on television.
That's tough, though, because if I'm Melo, I'd rather have Marc Gasol than Jahlil Okafor right now. Only because...
Worst case scenario, you have Jahlil play at the 4.
But
Jahlil's a post-up guy. He wants the ball in his hands.
If you have
Melo doesn't want to give the ball to anybody
Okafor
like that.
Would be a lock. Because you'd have the number one pick, so you could pick anybody. Whereas Marc Gasol has the free will to say, do I want to be in New York?
No, I know. I know what you mean. They control Jahlil's destiny.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is, I don't know if Jahlil is a great talent, NBA-ready guy. I don't know if he works with a guy like Melo, who Melo wants to take the shots. Jahlil's not your defensive center that I've come in. If you compare Joel Embiid to Jahlil, it's
but
night and day.
Carmelo doesn't need really a defender. He needs a secondary scorer because he's drawing all the attention. Now you put Jahlil in the mix. And then you get Rondo, and he's just organizing the show and playing defense. I mean, that would make New York basketball like a dream to watch again. And I'm sure the NBA with Commissioner Adam Silver, who's from Brooklyn, New York, grew up a Knicks fan.
But if you look at it, too, when Melo played with a low-post scorer in Stoudemire, the team struggled.
They're going to have, like, a pickpocket guy do the lottery balls, and he's just going to, like, flip them and be like, oh, the Knicks, and the Bucks are, like, the other ball that should have gotten picked.
The team around Carmelo Anthony this year was awful. Just there's not a top 15 player at their position other than Carmelo Anthony.
Phil Jackson flopped for a guy who's getting $12 million to do what he's doing. He put together a pretty good roster on paper that just didn't pan out. And
he even admitted he failed. He was like, oh, I screwed up.
It's like, oh, yeah,
it's $12 million. And it's kind of like, we're going to give you some leeway because you got,
They beat the Cavs on opening night, and they're like, the Knicks are...
Thumped by the Cavs on Saturday.
I don't like Melo playing with a low post scorer.
Played with a low post scorer.
He played with Amari Stoudemire.
Yeah, Amari was a low post scorer. He was more of he played in the paint area, but he liked to step back and hit the long two. And he wasn't really healthy. We never really got to see them play together.
And plus, when he played together, it was like the trade, so they never really got time to develop chemistry or
to
anything.
Gel, cause
then it was the lockout season, so they had like half a training camp. So like you didn't really get an opportunity.
It was either no time or... Amari's like, taking a bath and wine, see you guys later. Yeah.
What I want to see is I want to see a team that you have solid scorers, but... And Melo's, because Melo would love to be the dominant scorer on the team. And most teams he will be. But I think if you can get a guy like Gasol to be at your five, Rondo at your one, you got great defenders at their positions, good rebounders, and Rondo's going to pass the ball. And Marc Gasol is the best passing big man in the game.
You know what? They're not going to get those two guys in New York because Rondo's going to want 100 mil. Gasol's going to want 100 mil. You can't have $300 million on your books unless you want, like,
nobody else on
your
team.
Derrell Wright coming off your bench. Like, who?
Wait, they just keep the team they have right now. They're starting five.
It's going to be awful. So
well, they got Langston Galloway.
No, that's
so
it.
If they have Jahel, they can get one more max contract.
But you have Tim Hardaway Jr. at your two.
Oh, yeah. And he's going to save the world.
Tim Hardaway Jr. is a good player. That's why they traded Shumpert and Smith.
Clay Anthony early.
What are you talking about? Iman Shumpert's coming back to New York.
Yeah, he's
although
coming.
J.R. Smith is coming back to New York.
They go to the Cavs and they're hugging each other.
They probably would.
They'd be like, Jahel and Rondo? No, they're not going back. We're coming
back. They'll never
back.
Go back to New York. Look, they're all pumped to be in there. They stunk it up in New York. I've never liked Iman Shumpert.
I wouldn't want to build my team around
him. I didn't think he was that good. And then he comes to the Knicks and he's...
Watching him develop in his career, it's really looking at a younger version of Tony Allen. I mean, his ceiling is Tony Allen. He can't really score. Yes, he's athletic.
He can dunk, that's it.
He can dunk, he's athletic. But really, he's a lockdown defender and that's all he's going to be.
Yeah, that's what all the people in New York are saying. Let him develop, let him develop. I don't see him developing.
He was originally drafted to be the point guard, like the first season with D'Antoni.
No, he cannot
when Amari was still good, he was playing the point guard position. Yeah.
He was like he was in the 20s. Like, I don't know if you could pick your franchise guard in the 20s.
Marshawn Brooks was picked by Brooklyn. He's their franchise guard.
Marshawn Brooks, he was taken ninth, right? The ninth overall.
Where is Marshawn Brooks?
He got traded to Boston, and then I don't know where he went after that.
Where did he go?
He's in the D League.
He's not in the D League. He must be in the league.
He's not an NBA roster.
No, because he was drafted by Brooklyn.
He went to the Celtics.
No,
he was on the Knicks. I mean, he went to the Lakers. He was on the Lakers last year. He was on the Warriors. Then they went, and then in that trade with
was it
the Steve Blake trade? Then he went to the Lakers. I think he's on the Lakers D League team.
No, he scored 40 in Providence when he was at Providence, and everyone was like, "This guy's a legitimate prospect."
The thing with Marshawn Brooks is, Marshawn Brooks just. How do you not make the Lakers team? Like, the team like that, you should be able to make. I mean, I don't
know. The Lakers are good
to be honest,
year.
He might be playing in.
What was lazy? I remember watching Europe. The association when they did a season on the Nets and their coach, Avery Brooks.
Avery Johnson,
I'm sorry.
Brooks.
He was going nuts because he was like, Marshawn, you can't play defense. All you want to do is score.
He was an okay player. I just feel bad for him because,
he has so much.
He had a situation with the Warriors, and then they're like, possible NBA title, and then he gets traded to the Lakers. Did the nothing, Warriors. Except when Kobe got hurt, they were like, I'm so tired of when I see the Lakers on primetime games, because it's like, even if Kobe was healthy, this game would still be horrible.
We got word from the studio. We want to hear about A-Rod. What do you guys think about A-Rod?
Holden, we talked about A-Rod.
It's your turn. Transition to baseball? All right, so when A-Rod, we're talking about A-Rod obviously showing up to training camp early to make a good impression on the Yankees' grass. Showing up early saying, I'm grateful to play this game 20 times. I mean, I heard something strange listening to Dan Le Batard. I don't know why I was listening to Dan Le Batard.
Jeremy was probably listening to him as well.
Poppy, see or not?
He can't speak English.
Yeah.
He can't speak
and they're like, English. You know what? I think A-Rod's perspective on steroids was honest. You know, he took steroids because he wanted to live up to that contract. He didn't do it before.
Live up to the contract.
He did it after the contract because he wanted to live up to
He already lived up to it when he was on the Mariners.
Like, look at this guy. He's got busted, what is it, three times now?
Or two times? 50 if you get suspended once. Then if you get suspended again...
But how many times have allegations come out against him?
At least three.
At least three, right? And now he's like, you know what? I'm going to do my best to make the team.
You're getting paid
over $20 million. You're on the team. You're not just going to sit on the bench. You're going to sell tickets. People are going to want to see you play.
He's not going to play. There's no position for him.
Well, I mean, they might play him at DH.
You're going to pay money to come see a designated hitter?
Because I
mean, the only good designated hitter that's been consistent is David Ortiz.
I mean, look, when I hear rumors that you're training with Barry Bonds,
what about Billy Butler?
DH time, baby.
Well, he started at first base and kind of transitioned over to DH.
Look,
there's rumors he was going to get games at first base.
A-Rod?
Yeah.
Look, I think.
Why doesn't he play left field?
I think the Yankees coach Girardi, he's a good man. He's going to want to give him his fair shot. The brass really don't want him to play. They just hate his guts.
I think you have to play him.
You're going to have to play him because he's making over $20 million. There's going to be people in the stands who are waiting to heckle him the minute he steps up to the plate.
Imagine
when he comes to Boston?
The worst he's going to do is be a DH.
They might cheer for him because he's ruining the Yankees.
The Yankees last season without A-Rod, even with A-Rod, they couldn't hit very well. So they're going to be craving for a guy who can hit, you know, 300, high 200s, and I think A-Rod could give you some of that in the short term, but he's aging, he's up there.
They got to get to the postseason.
Maybe the training with Barry Bonds works out because Barry's like, hey man, you didn't do roids the right way. I'll teach you how to do roids the right way.
Isn't he 40 now?
A-Rod?
Yeah.
No, I think he's like 38.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Let me ask you something.
This dude is done. He's going to be so relevant this year.
Let me ask you guys something about baseball. Stephen A. Smith is a big, he hates intentional walking in baseball.
It.
What do you guys think about the intentional walk?
There were rumors that they were going to get rid of the defensive shift. For, like, when David Ortiz comes up, they're going to get rid of that.
So, like, the umpires are like, get back to your position?
Yeah. I thought that was the stupidest thing I've
ever heard. No, I think if any time a defensive baseball team is like, here's an open spot in the field. It's the offensive player's job to hit to swing it there. Yeah. What are they going to be restricted to, like a 5 foot area?
I'm assuming
can't
like you play like the generic shortstop or like the generic.
Well, where is the boundary for
well,
shortstop?
You can't be on the other side, second base, if you're playing shortstop. If they're going to put that rule in, I'm assuming. I mean, I like how they're trying to speed up the game and try to make it more entertaining. But that's like a strategy. Like you can't completely. Like, if you're just going to stand on the mound for a minute and 20 seconds in between pitches, like, that's not really a strategy. That's just, like, stalling time. But, like, if you're playing to a hitter's advantage, like, you're playing the odds, like, that's a strategy.
I can't tell you how much I hate A-Rod.
Especially
prior to
what's his apology?
Yeah, we talked about that last show.
I'll touch on that in a minute. But remember prior to his suspension, his latest suspension, I remember watching him on ESPN. He was on like a local New York radio station. They were like, and the host was like, Alex, did you do steroids? He's like, no, I did not. I did not do it.
The best part of the whole situation is the only reason why he admitted it was because they were threatening to put him in jail.
Yeah.
They were like, we'll give you full immunity.
He was like, you never had any relationship with Anthony Bosch. He's like, this guy's trying to discredit my reputation. And he went on like a 20-minute rant, and it looked so convincing and so like he was like so full of rage. And then obviously he got suspended, and he's like, comes out, I'm so grateful.
My favorite moment of that season.
And then he does the handwritten letter.
Oh, yeah, no.
Because, I mean, everyone was like, it's so genuine, and it's so to the fans. And it's everyone at ESPN, it was so genuine to the fans because he did it in cursive, and no one writes cursive anymore, and he was so formal. It's because he was like, oh, man, they're going to grill me in front of the media.
You know what
I
heard?
If I step up to that podium, I better just write a letter and write in cursive so I look so cool.
Eli Manning, like, he pretty much bet his salary that A-Rod wasn't on steroids.
Really?
No.
Oh.
But that'd be funny if he did because Aaron Rodgers was betting that Ryan Braun didn't do it.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure A-Rod would love to get traded. I'm sure he would
love to
play. There's
rumors he was going to the Marlins like 2 years ago.
Oh, I'm sure the Marlins would. He would love to go to the Marlins because
he could train some of those.
He could meet up with Bosch down there.
And he's like, yo, man, we don't have to fly up anymore. We can get those needles in now.
No, the worst part about that whole situation is he apologizes, and the only reason he admits it is because they're threatening to throw him in jail if he doesn't, you know, say
that.
So
they don't threaten him.
He's probably still saying he's not on steroids.
He's probably still on that radio show going, Bud Selig is just trying to ruin my reputation. That man should, you know, it's like saying all that stuff. It was just so vehement. I remember watching it. And then seeing when he's come back, I'm so grateful to play baseball again.
Well, the Yankees the last year, no one liked Teixeira was played awful.
Tanaka went down after starting out pretty strong.
And then Sabathia was hurt all year. Apparently he's like 30 pounds heavier than he was last year.
I didn't even know Tanaka had Tommy John surgery, which is crazy. I mean, 1 year, boom, it's Tommy John surgery. He had a strong start last
year. Tommy John surgery doesn't seem to matter. These guys come back and they're like they're better than they were before.
They just elbow surgery.
I mean, he just signed this big money pitcher. He starts out strong and he just gets hurt like immediately. CC Sabathia looked pretty trim and skinny last season. Now he reports to camp they're like he's like 300 pounds.
Then they had a Pineda from the Mariners.
Who's just like pine tar.
He just didn't really pan out well.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a mess in New York.
No, you know,
Look, Derek, that's why everyone threw all those celebrations for Derek Jeter, because now we're at this
they're in a new stage of Yankees.
Who is going to be the new face of the Yankees?
There's no one right now.
It's funny.
Brett Gardner.
There's literally no one.
It's funny, because I've been watching the Yankees my whole life, and you watch the Yankeeographies on the YES Network, and you see these older teams, and it just doesn't seem like the Yankees anymore.
Jacoby
Ellsbury.
They overpaid Jacoby Ellsbury to lose Robinson Cano that year. That's all I'm saying.
Cano should be the Dodgers right now. They're the Mariners. I'll tell you right now.
Mariners are a good team.
The Mariners are a good team. They have King Felix, their ace pitcher. Cano's there. They got another couple other pieces.
Nelson Cruz.
They
got pieces.
They got some guy last year.
Jackson from Detroit.
Austin Jackson.
Right. And, I mean, they're building out there, and it's just so depressing when New York just doesn't have a good sports team.
Didn't Ichiro go back to the Mariners, too?
There's nothing better than when the Yankees just suck.
Didn't Ichiro go back to the Mariners?
Even if they suck.
I don't know if he did. He might have.
If they suck, you just want every single New York team to have, like, a face of the franchise. I mean, the Knicks have Melo.
The Mets have had David
The Jets
Wright
have
for
nobody.
So
it was Rex Ryan until he got fired.
It's Geno Smith now. Decent. No, the face of the franchise is Geno Smith.
Get out of here with Geno
Percy Harvin. No, I'm just kidding.
That's why they're kind of playing drafting Marcus Mariota.
And the Yankees don't have anyone. It was Derek. This year it's going to be A-Rod.
Before that, it was Donnie Baseball.
Steroid,
then you had Thurman Munson.
Don't get me. Derek Jeter, yes, he's facing Yankees. Best situation in the history of baseball.
So if he goes to the Astros, number one overall pick that year,
he is literally like a generic, like, he's like the J.J. Hardy. He's
some
just like
that.
A good shortstop that's like, all right, your team picks him up and it's like, good, but it's not like
so
we
apparently,
just got the best
one of the
league.
Assistant general managers quit his job after the Astros didn't select Jeter. He's like, I'm out of here, guys.
I'm actually going to be so excited to watch, like, baseball this season. Just see the Yankees burn.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome.
Be so awful.
Listen. One of my favorite moments with the whole A-Rod scandal
but
is
if the
when,
Red Sox
when they played
good,
the Red Sox.
And if the Jays aren't good and
the Red Sox
aren't
good.
There's got to be. I just want at least two other teams in that division to be good because then it's fun to watch that division. Otherwise,
the end of the season,
all of them are terrible
the
like they were last year.
The worst is when the Red Sox and
awful.
The Yankees both suck in the same year because it just seems like something's missing in the postseason. Because you're so accustomed to seeing
one of
at
teams
least
being,
one
yeah.
of them in there, if not both. And it's just, it's weird.
It almost doesn't seem like a bait. Like it's,
yeah, it's just
we're almost
weird.
Growing up here to not even think about the other teams out west. You almost just think it's here. But I remember last year with A-Rod, when he went up to Boston, they were booing him. And he hits that home run and he goes nuts running around the bases. Like I just love that because like, I liked A-Rod.
And then a needle falls out of his pocket.
How funny would that have been?
Please jump. Oh, my bad.
You know what I want to see a defensive player do?
The third base umpires like... Oh.
I want to see a defensive player like the first baseman. He hits a home run, like they like start throwing needles at him or something like that, or like he throws one out of his pocket, like, "Hey, A-Rod, you drop something." It's like a needle on the ground.
Oh, that'd be beautiful.
A-Rod.
Anyways, moving on. Derek Rose, Holden.
You had a bold prediction.
Holden.
Let's see the first one of our first shows before the NBA season started, when you went off on who you're most interested to see. And you said Rose.
I just want to know what happened to Derrick Rose. What's the situation?
He's hurt right now.
Oh.
But Chicago,
well, he's just a
listen,
little hurt.
Chicago
stub toe.
Chicago just came out and said it's not as bad as the previous torn meniscus.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. So
it looks
like 14 months.
Yeah. Or he might not retire. He might come back in 5 years.
I was feeling pretty good about myself because prior to the All-Star break, he had 30.7 assists and they. Thrashed the Cavs before the All-Star break. So you're looking at, they blew out the Cavs. He looks like the old Derrick Rose.
Yeah,
and then he comes out and tore meniscus. And Coach Thibodeau is like, it's so unfair. He comes out and says, so unfair. And look, this is the best team he's ever had. Jimmy Butler is developing.
Everybody laughed at me when I said him.
I know, but now he's finally developing into a quality player. You got Gasol, you got Joakim Noah playing at an all-pro level. This team just needs to be healthy, and they're deadly. But and especially in the Eastern Conference, but Derrick Rose, this guy, I mean, he could get a paper cut and be out for 2 months. He's just so
awesome.
Fragile mentally. He's 26 years old.
So he's got to trade him.
And,
yeah, let's trade
so,
him.
I get so mad.
I would trade him for Russell
Westbrook. Why don't you put
him
in the Knicks?
Has had three knee surgeries for torn meniscus
injuries.
He'll
be back in like 2 months.
He comes
so back Kevin Durant.
And he's averaging 26-8. He just doesn't care. He plays like Kobe. And you got Derrick Rose out there averaging 18-5.
Guys, I know Russell is back in 2 months. Listen, I'm on my eighth. I'm getting there. I'm only 104%, but I'll be back soon.
I've only sat out.
I'm not ready for the playoffs,
back, guys. You know, it's just so disappointing to see, especially when you were the number one pick. You know, the NBA rigged it
and
for
it was
you.
Fixed. And
it was fixed. They set
it
up
fixed.
For you.
You definitely got 3% chance to win, Justin.
Could you
come
imagine
on.
If this guy is so fragile mentally over a knee injury? Could you imagine what he would be like playing in like Milwaukee or LA or New York and?
Yeah, but they didn't have anybody when he was playing in Chicago.
He can live with his parents for Pete's sake. He doesn't need to buy a house or cook for himself or dress himself.
I mean, he could. He's making money.
He could just be comfortable playing at home. But if he went to Milwaukee or Orlando and was away from home, oh my God, how could he fend for himself?
And that's why.
Or if he went to New York,
it's not fixed. It's not fixed.
Or
it's
if
not
he
fixed.
Went to New York or LA in those big pressure markets. And then he had the knee injury. Oh, man, he'd probably just retire or jump off the Empire State Building.
I'll tell you right
you
now.
You guys remember when he won the MVP and he was the next Michael Jordan?
He was never. Well, I mean, look. He never played D like Michael Jordan.
I think it's fair to say that Derrick Rose and Russell Westbrook are the two most athletic point guards in NBA history. You've never seen two guys that big, that fast, that strong play
John Starks.
The point guard position. And the fact that Russell Westbrook and Derrick Rose have basically had the same injury history, and what Russell Westbrook has come
so is
back.
That is that style of play bad? The way they play?
Russell Westbrook.
It's just risky.
It's risky, but Russell Westbrook obviously doesn't care because he's come back and averaged 26-8.
Yeah, but he can get hurt tomorrow.
It's just you have to have a different mindset than
it's a mindset thing. Because I'm watching Derrick Rose before the All-Star break against the Cavs, and throughout the season, he's had flashes and moments where you're like, that was the guy who won the NBA MVP. There's no question he can do it physically. It's all up here. It's all mental with Derrick
and
Rose.
And all down here in his knee.
But the thing with Westbrook is Westbrook can get hurt tomorrow. He could tear something in his knee.
The different thing is Russell Westbrook is expected to miss 4 months. He misses like a month
Russell
and a half.
Russell Westbrook could
and
break.
And then Derrick Rose.
Could break his elbow, dislocate his elbow, and he'd be like, yo, KD, can you just chop this off?
Yo,
I'm gonna go back
in. Rondo dislocated his elbow in that
Derrick
Heat
Rose
game. I was going nuts, and he came back out
in
the field, I mean the court, and he's getting that's what he does. He's getting the crowd fired up.
Like the knuckle push-ups from McCullough.
No, I hated that. And then Garnett goes down, and he's
that was awesome.
Because I remember Rondo, Dwayne Wade went for the steal,
Russell Westbrook
and Rondo fell backwards, and just his elbow just bent in half.
Or Westbrook, hits a three, and he just goes... Like he's just got confidence in Westbrook.
But if he goes to the hoop,
he's just like
Westbrook.
I'm thinking about life after basketball.
They're like Westbrook would be like, you were triple teamed. You shot that game to win the game. You missed it. What do you think? Well, I think I had the best shot out there.
That was the best shot out there.
But Rose isn't gonna retire. He's obviously gonna come back. He's got 2 years and $40 million left on the table.
I think he'll be back by the
playoffs. You're not gonna leave that.
You can argue that was one of the worst contracts in NBA history because the dude just didn't play throughout the entire contract.
Right. He's got 2 years, $40 million left. I think Chicago's going to retain him, to be honest, because, you know, people want to see Derrick Rose. And I think he wants to stay in Chicago. I think they'll trade him. He's not going to be interested.
I feel like he'll
be
the type of guy who stays in Chicago, even if after this deal they give him, they're obviously not going to give him $20 million again.
Look, it's, you know, even if they do trade him, I'm sure Chicago is a great market. They're going to get another guy to play the point guard position. They have talent on that roster to attract somebody, but I think they're going to keep Rose. Look, I feel bad for Tom Thibodeau. You know, this was he's a great coach. He deserves to go deep into the postseason.
The Bulls will still be very good
out.
This year. The Bulls
will
be great.
I know, but they're not
going
to make it to the Eastern Conference.
I still think they're going to make it.
You gotta be kicking yourself with the Bulls. You almost wanted the injury happen like a day or two earlier because the trade deadline goes by. Maybe they could have got a guy like a Reggie Jackson or something if they had a reason to. And then they can't really do much now. Like
I think he'll be back by the playoffs. They mentioned it's not.
There's absolutely no way Derrick Rose plays
a minute. No, this is the thing. When he got hurt last year and he missed the entire year after only playing 10 games from a meniscus tear, reports were that he had the same injury as Westbrook and he could have came back in 2 months and he didn't. Now he's got the same injury. Reports are it's not bad.
Not as bad as
before. He can come back by the postseason, which is in June. You know, he's going to be out 2 months. So what is it? Basically March, so April, May. He's going to be back for the postseason. But he's just not mentally strong enough.
I think he's got to come back. I think he's got to come back to prove the doubters.
He doesn't care.
He had to come back last year. He had to come back last year because they had a good roster.
No, this team is so much better this year, though.
They were competitive last year, too. He was 25 years old. He could have came back last year, and he chose not to.
But even with Rose, they weren't beating the Heat. This year, they have a chance.
He is not coming back.
Derrick Rose, if he comes back, he's going to come off the bench and play like 15 minutes. There's no way Derrick Rose is pushing himself.
I even without Rose, I think this Bulls team is legit because Butler is turning into a superstar. Pau Gasol is coming out of his shell. Not a shell. He's not a young guy.
Do they have Heinrich that's going to step in for him?
They'll have Aaron Brooks step in.
Oh,
who could just score. He's not going to really pass. They're
going
to be a good team. I mean, if Butler can... Butler plays great when Rose is not in the lineup.
I think without Rose, they're going to slide a little bit and potentially
get... So you think they're a second-round knockout?
Oh, I think they're going to make the playoffs, but I think they're going to get knocked out, like you said, in the second round, because right now they could potentially get knocked out in the first round because
depending on who they play.
The Wizards are only half a game back, and they could potentially fall down far enough to get matched up with the Wizards, and I think
that'd be bad.
The Wizards are going to send them right out of the playoffs if they play against the Wizards.
Listen, people, you want to say what you want to say about the East. It's looking, like, pretty good.
It's looking better.
These playoffs are going
to
be great
this
year.
But like the Wizards, they might contend to the East, but is that team going to go and beat a Western Conference
If you think about every single team in the East, fully healthy, 100%, it's pretty competitive. Not like the West. I think everyone makes a lot out of the West because they're just so deep. And it's not really a quality of the first eight teams. It's just every single, you know, all the teams in the West are capable
of beating and winning
playoff teams and beating each other on a given basis. Whereas in the East, you don't have that. But the teams that are in the playoff hunt right now are pretty good at 100%. And it's just disappointing to see that Derrick Rose won't be in the playoffs because I like watching him play. He's a great athlete. And that Chicago team is so much more fun to watch when he's in the lineup. And the fact that he's not there just makes the basketball less exciting.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, I was so upset when I saw Rose go down because I wanted to see them go far because, I mean, from the beginning, everybody's picking them to it'd be the Bulls and Cavs in the Eastern Conference Finals, and then we'll see Rose go up against LeBron once more. It's Jimmy Butler the best. They'll probably get clobbered if they go up against them because the Cavs are just, if the Cavs figure it out, they're good.
Jimmy Butler, 21 points.
Jimmy Butler will.
What if Jimmy Butler carries the Bulls?
He will.
He
dominates
the finals, and then he's getting a max deal. Who's he going to?
He's worth the max
Who's
deal.
He going?
I want to see him go to the Hawks, but I think he's going to stay with the Bulls.
Why would he stay with the Bulls?
Because he likes it there. The team gave him a chance. But if he goes to the Hawks,
they're not going to afford giving him up. No.
No.
Yeah, but how are they going to give him a max contract?
Because Pau Gasol took a reduced deal.
Oh, yeah.
Joakim Noah doesn't really have. He doesn't have a max contract. His maximum deal was like $50
million.
Don't leave,
he makes nothing.
I mean, they could possibly work out a deal to keep Jimmy Butler there. But I think if he plays out of his mind without Rose in that lineup,
they might not be able to keep him.
They might not be able to keep him.
I would love to see him go to the Hawks.
No, you want to see him go to the Bucks.
Dude, if he goes to the Bucks, I'm putting my application into Marquette.
Watch NBA
I'm transferring to Marquette if he goes
Josh
there.
Your brother Josh can watch the Hawks and just love the Hawks for the Hawks.
And I could love Jimmy Butler.
You can watch the Hawks because you love Jimmy Butler.
I said if he goes to the Jimmy Butler goes to the Bucks, I'm transferring
to
Marquette.
Marquette.
I'm transferring
to
Marquette.
Every Bucks game.
Every Bucks game. And out there, you get a free chili from Wendy's when the Bucks win.
Do you really?
Yeah. So you always see like if you follow the Bucks on Twitter @Bucks.
Oh, you follow the Bucks on Twitter.
Yeah. So that everybody's like, got my free chili tonight. It was great. Thank you, Jabari, for hitting the game winner.
Justin's going to be coming back to North Haven after he goes to Marquette. And Jeremy and I would be like, hey, man, you want to go to Wendy's? And he's going to be like, oh, no, dude.
I'm
done with Wendy's. Because the Bucks will be nasty winning every game. They're going to win 50 games that year. I'll be eating 50 things of chili.
Does it have to be a home game or is it just any game?
You know, I'm not
that's
sure.
That's true because if
they win
like,
if it's just a home game,
a year,
then
that's
maybe
fine.
That's
no, I think it's any game. But you can't, like, it's not like every Wendy's in the... What if it was every Wendy in the United States? Every, like, the Bucks win.
The Bucks.
Listen, I'm going to take this off. We're going to go to Town Sports. I know you guys have been doing a lot of coverage on the women's basketball team. Doing good.
Justin and I, in our TV sports production class, just did a commentary, a play-by-play commentary on the East Haven basketball game where Jill Johnson surpassed 1,000 points for her North Haven career, which was a pretty big deal. You know, you don't see that often in high school, and Jill Johnson broke the record against East Haven off of a floater. They still lost the game to East Haven, but they're in the state playoffs, which is exciting for North
Haven. And they upset.
Listen, I got 5 minutes here. Tell me, what's the shots? We got a state championship on the line here.
Well, they're 10-10. They're the 22nd seed playing Northwest Catholic in West Hartford, so it's an away game. Northwest Catholic's an 11th seed, and they're 15-5.
Listen, they upset in the SEC tournament. They got an upset.
Yeah, I mean, they're good because they're really good defensively. Yeah.
What we got for X factors on the offensive side?
Well, Jill Johnson, Jill, obviously.
Who else we got? Who
Nina
else
Paluka needs to get on them boards, man. She's the
Yeah,
team
see, we've been covering the team. We covered one game, so I'm probably...
We're talking about, you know, Jill Johnson was on fire in that... Well, not... She was on fire in a game we covered before, but in the East Haven game...
They double and triple teamed her.
They double triple teamed her, took her out of the game. East Haven was lighting it up from three. Miranda Gladwin. She hit like 4 threes.
Yeah, you were like, Miranda Gladwin.
She scored 12 points, 4 threes in a row in the first quarter.
I do that in my sleep.
Justin was joking around.
Jeremy
like,
hits a three and he's like...
He was just like, take her to the burn unit. She's on fire.
Yeah, we were going to be like, we're live at Yale reporting in the burn unit because Yale's on fire today. But listen to this, Holden.
But yeah, our teacher, Mr. Falcon, obviously the boys basketball coach, wants us to get coverage of the girls game. We might go with...
Where is it?
It's at West Hartford. It's a long road.
It's like 45 minutes.
We might send North Haven sports analyst Marty Trout to cover the game.
Absolutely.
So. Falcon,
I think you had something to say about this women's basketball team.
No. All right, I'll cover the basketball team really quickly, but then I gotta tell Holden about something important here. The girls' basketball team, we're experts. I might be most qualified because I've covered them twice now.
Oh, two times?
I went to the game personally.
Ooh.
I've done two games.
You did the? Did you do the girls' game?
I did the Hillhouse.
Oh, you
game.
Did the first girls'
yeah,
game.
I did
so
the first
we're
game.
We're equally as we're oh, the best oh. we're the best people in North Haven to cover girls' basketball here.
I mean, I'd like to say I know my share of girls' basketball, but I mean, I guess I can't compare to you guys.
But Holden, so we were at Hamden Regional practice. It was like poetry in motion, our passing.
Listen,
like,
Holden, you put a 2-3 zone on our team.
It's unstoppable.
We're swinging it, going to the middle.
We'll beat East Haven girls. I don't care if
Miranda
Gladwin
does it. Swinging it out for a wide open three. Oh my God! You can't stop it, Holden.
It was.
I challenge you. To get five men
to play
2-3 zone, and you're not beating us.
Mitchell.
Yeah, get him.
Mitchell's on the team.
Get him. I want you to get LeBron, Kyrie.
How about LeBron Jr., LeBron James Jr.?
He was getting, like, recruited.
Apparently LeBron James and Stephen A. Smith on his show today said his sources tell him that LeBron James' son has 3 offers from legitimate Division I programs.
Yeah.
That's because
Kentucky.
He's going to turn into this
10 years old.
He's going to Kentucky.
He'll be at Kentucky, and then the Cavs will get the first overall pick that year, no matter what.
Conspiracy theory.
LeBron will be like 45,
already.
Like the president of basketball operations there, and then his son will go to the team.
But before the show ends, Justin is still in search of a prom date.
Oh God.
Let's get his number on the bottom of the board. We got to get him a girl, Holden.
Who's
we
that?
We got to get him a girl. Listen.
Listen.
You can call here right now. Throw the number up.
Calling right
now.
We
got a minute, 30 seconds left. There it is. Call that
number.
And
Jake Brangie, don't you call in here.
We're waiting for the call.
If that phone rings, I'm going to freak out.
All right, we'll try next week for you.
We'll try next week. Well, by next week.
Jill, I know
listen,
you're watching.
Listen, in studio, they're saying you're supposed to ask them. So if there's someone you'd like to ask, go for it.
I don't know. I'm not.
what hurts?
I'm just so stressed about college. I can't focus on prom.
I know. I heard that your mom was willing to go. She said she wanted a shout out today. So,
my mom.
Why isn't your mom called and asked about LeBron James?
We'll give you 30 seconds of FaceTime here.
No, I think you shout need out. A FaceTime.
Oh, okay. Mom, what's up?
If we go to McDonald's next week, I really want to do that payment where you have to like call your mom or something
call your friend. Oh,
yeah.
I think that's over. I think it was only through Valentine's Day.
Yeah, that was like one McDonald's where they had cameras.
Yeah.
It's not going to be happening here.
No, yeah. But
Thanks.
I mean, anyways. Hold on, you need some FaceTime? We got 30 seconds left.
Just shout out to Max Palillo, Justin's little brother. Apparently, Mr. Falcon has been bragging about him. Sports production class.
He did a nasty thing.
We have to mention Peyton.
Jeremy's brother
Peyton is the next Russell Westbrook. The guy is just a solid block of muscle, and he grabs every freaking rebound. But did miss a pick, so I'm sorry, Peyton.
That's all we have for this edition of Sports Talk. I'm Jeremy Freeman.
I'm Justin Palillo.
I'm Holden Pirelli.
We'll see you guys next week.